Okay, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. I'm John Tonello, host of Tenable Cloud Security Coffee Break. We'll wait a couple seconds for people to join. As they flow in, I'm happy to be joined again by Tom Croll, who's an advisor with Lionfish Tech Advisors, former Gartner guy, big head security guy. I don't mean like egomaniacal, Tom. I mean, your head's packed full of security and, you know, particularly cloud security kinds of knowledge. So I'm very happy to have you here again.
Thank you, John. You're too kind. I've been told my head's in the clouds quite a few times, so hopefully, yeah.
I got to work that into something, you know, your head in the cloud security. The reason we have Tom aboard is, I was thinking about this yesterday, Tom. I wanted to say you're co-coiner of the term CNAPP, the whole idea of cloud native application protection platforms. It's a mouthful. This is why we have acronyms. Is broad and wide ranging. And this episode, we're going to use it as, you know, conceptually to not only look at what exists today, but take that forward look, because we don't expect anybody to have all the elements of CNAPP in place, and we'll define it here and talk about that. So that's the goal here. So, you know, some of our other episodes, like, you know, if you have Kubernetes or you don't have cloud security posture management, there are certain risks, and there's some great tools for that. CNAPP, not everything is invented yet, not everything is pulled together yet, not just for Tenable, but for others, but these are roadmap kinds of things, so we're forward looking.
Absolutely. I must apologize for being responsible for some of this acronym soup. You may be surprised to know that it's actually quite difficult to get a new acronym published in Gartner. I think I brought it in when I was the leader of the hype cycle in 2021 for cloud security. And Neil and I had been writing about CNAPP for 2 years. We'd been mentioning it in the Cloud Workload Protection Platform, CWPP. Sorry, that's another one. I'm not responsible for that, but it was Gartner. And we'd been talking about it, and vendors had pages advertising CNAPP. We were still getting pushback internally. Like, no, we don't know what that is, so you can't have it. I'm like, well, right, okay. So we had to fight quite hard to bring that into the hype cycle that year, and now it's grown legs. So, it's been a journey.
It's interesting, you know, that the history of these things, you know, they emerge as the evolution happens. Before we get too far into that, I have to always kick off my first poll, which of course is, what's your beverage? And, you know, it is a coffee break. I recognize, Tom, by your accent, that coffee may not be your first choice. What are you drinking?
Well, it usually is, but I've got a cup of tea today. So I thought I'd better keep the stereotype going. And British people do drink tea. So it's also 4 o'clock in the afternoon for me. So I'll be awake until like 4 a.m. if I'm drinking coffee now.
Yes.
So.
Yeah. And we've talked about that in the past. Like, you know, I have a 2-cup limit before noon. coffee is popular, but we don't make any judgments on, you know, what time of day. It's noon or 4 o'clock. Somewhere in the world. So, you know, if you're watching this kicking back somewhere and you have something a little stronger, perfectly fine. We like that. It makes people creative sometimes. You know, I a quick aside on that, you know, if you ever watch Mad Men set in the 60s and executives doing their thing, you know, the three martini lunch was a thing. And I think it helps explain why there were fins on cars in the 50s and 60s. You know, as guys are going to lunch, having three martinis, coming back to work and going, hey, Lou, I have a great idea. So
Evolved to like a 6-pint lunch as well in the UK. So, you know,
yeah, that is not this. I'm not advocating that. I am not, I'm not judging. So coffee's our big winner. I'm always very interested to see a lot of people drinking water and proud of that. So, so with that, stay hydrated. Which is good, you know, because we are, there's someone, I heard someone say recently, you know, sitting is the new smoking. So if you have to get up and get a drink and get some water and get coffee or something like that, it's good just to get up and walk around. So today talking about CNAPP. If you haven't watched this show before, we do have all these shows archived on the Tenable.com site. They're also available on YouTube. I encourage you to go and look at those. We had a great episode a couple weeks ago, about a month ago now, with Ryan Bragg talking about agent versus agentless. Last week we were talking about some new things with agentless and Azure. And today brings us to CNAPP. So just to level set us, Tom, what is CNAPP?
Well, I thought you might ask me this very strangely. So what I have here, I'm going to read you Gartner's current definition, and then I'm going to tell you what this word soup means. So Gartner currently defines CNAPP as cloud-native application protection platforms are a unified and tightly integrated set of security and compliance capabilities designed to secure and protect cloud-native applications across development and production. CNAPPs consolidate a large number of previously siloed capabilities, including container scanning, cloud security posture management, infrastructure as code scanning, cloud infrastructure entitlements management. Most of these are made up by Gartner, these acronyms as well. runtime cloud workload protection and runtime vulnerability configuration scanning. So you could be forgiven for thinking this is just a way of getting rid of 10 acronyms and making one new one. So you could look at it like that. I can tell you what the inspiration was and the thinking behind it. And hopefully people might get a better sense of what it was. You know, it's fine to have a complete list of features. What do you need to be a CNAPP? And vendors are usually asking for these things so they can feature in research and things. But really, I like to just tell people, since the evolution of CSPM and our scanning capabilities in the CI/CD pipeline and automation, we can do repository scanning and we can take snapshots in live now. It's no longer enough to ask, is my cloud infrastructure secure? Now we need to be able to ask and answer, is my cloud application secure? It's not just the configuration of the infrastructure as code, but it's also what are we running in the virtual machines, containers, serverless, databases as a service, and how do we take all of that information and use multiple points of telemetry to create actionable, prioritized alerts that people can properly use and right. Move risk curve from a certain place to another place without all these false positives. So that was my initial thinking behind it. We've got the tools now. We've got multiple tools that can give us context. CSPM started off as a very noisy tool that said, look, you've got all of these misconfigurations, but it didn't tell you if they were exploitable. And, you know, I did it myself. So I was like, well, that was red yesterday. It'll be red tomorrow. Nothing's happened. So there we get not just alert fatigue, we get dashboard fatigue. We're like, oh yeah, red. It was red, don't worry. Now we can feasibly take these multiple points of telemetry from the image scanning repositories and say, okay, you've got SSH open on this port, But from your image repository, I can see you don't have SSH installed, and it's certainly not running on that port. So all of a sudden, this vulnerability goes from critical down to maybe a medium. You want to look for that. And conversely, if we can verify that SSH is running on that port, it's open to the world, and there's a vulnerability that we've taken from our vulnerability management software. You guys at Tenable know all about that. Then we can say, okay, this is priority one. Let's fix this today. The other ones can wait. And I think the popularity in this idea is all of a sudden teams can say, so I don't need to do these 200 ones. No, right. Just do the 5 and the risk will come down and we can prove it. So trying to help.
And the thing that, you know, as you give the dictionary definition, one thing stands out, it's very complicated. Not CNAPP in itself, but cloud security is complicated. And, you know, back in the day, security, and I was sketching out some of these things, and I've done this over time, like the evolution of security, which, you know, you used to have a data center and you had a lock on it and you walk in and stuff. And then, you know, there were firewalls and there's software firewall. The big challenge of cloud right out of the gate is you don't own it and control it. You don't have that. There's no geographic perimeter. It is now, you know, something else. So you really need tools to understand that environment, and not just one environment, right? Because as we've seen, everybody is using multiple clouds at once. So now you have that mix, and they all call things slightly different things. They have just certain different ways of doing things. And then your workloads at the same time are getting more and more complex. Microservices are much, you know, have a much larger attack surface than a monolithic application. Everything is virtual in these environments for the most part. And you're really, you know, there's a lot of moving parts. And I think what you just described is, you know, attacking each one of those particular complications. And most of all, giving you a sense of what's really important, what's truly critical. And, you know, you talked about attack path, and we're going to show off some stuff in Tenable one under attack path, which to me is always, it's fascinating because it's not just a proof point after the fact. We were talking a little earlier, it's a way to validate what you're about to do what you're thinking about doing, which brings it to a whole nother level, because who wants to play defense the whole time? You want to be on offense, you want to get ahead of this stuff. So
don't tell, right, John?
You say what?
Show, don't tell.
Yeah.
The amount of times as a security guy, I've been sitting there and saying, look, this has got a risk attached to it. And then it goes, and it, depending on what industry you're in, but I think every security person has been frustrated at some point. And you want to say, look, I know that in the past we might have been a little bit catastrophizing some of these things, but I really mean it this time. And if you can show an attack path, you can say, look, this is why it's exploitable with this port open and this vulnerability I can get across, then I can identify what vulnerabilities are there and what assets I can access from here. And you can show people that this vulnerability isn't just security catastrophizing again, then it's really helpful. It's going to be your friend to selling this piece of work that you are proposing that the business spend time doing. I mean, developers don't really want to do it because they want to do cool features. They want to get things moving, and it's not really why they got into it, to do security stories. But if you can show people with attack path, then it really helps your case as a security entity. So that's.
And before we dive into attack path, I want to go through some of the core ideas of CNAPP, and there are some core capabilities, and you listed off a lot of those as you were going through the definitions earlier. these things, some of them will be very familiar to you, you, the audience. Some may be slightly new, like attack path is relatively new compared to CSPM or vulnerability management, for sure. And I brought up my Tenable Cloud Security Dashboard. This is the misconfigurations view. And from of those pieces, sort of the I'm just going to switch over to the vulnerabilities tab. Because one of the first principles of this is the vulnerability management. And you mentioned visibility into your virtual machines and containers. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so one of the other things that I was pushing for some time was, as a former cloud security engineer and architect, I found that installing agents on everything was had a quite high overhead and managing these things. So in order to give us our misconfigurations on the control plane and have a look at what's happening inside our data layer, we can take snapshots and look for vulnerabilities from running virtual machines or containers. So there's a couple of ways that we can find these vulnerabilities. The vulnerabilities from the APIs, we can pull that out, and that's traditional CSPM from the configuration of your infrastructure. And then you want to see on this, it'd be great on the same page to see what vulnerabilities have I got running on my virtual machines. And then we can put these two pieces of information together and give them some context. It becomes a far more pressing concern and a far more practical way of doing things when it comes to containers. So if anybody wants to put an agent on every one of their containers, then okay, I'll happily take on that contract and do it for you, but it's going to cost you. So there's quite a few ways we can take misconfigurations and one from APIs and different sources of telemetry, and then combine them with vulnerability information that we have, whether it be from a database or from scanning our source code, Docker files, or our library of images, or repositories, or artifacts. And then we can give them a score with these combined pieces of information. So yeah, the way that we started doing this is moving ever forward and evolving to be more relevant. That's really what I want. Show me the ones I have to do, right, and why.
And that evolution, again, you know, we started out doing network scanning and agents, and now it's known as agentless. And as you said, you know, instead of installing an agent in everything and getting telemetry that way, looking at these snapshots, looking at other environmental configurations that way, and those other methods are remain valid. They're just not as practical and in the cloud. Like if you want to do what Tom said, install agents on everything, you could do those things.
Yeah.
But there's
saying you shouldn't. I mean, you still need agents for some of your estate, but it depends on your risk appetite, right?
Right. Totally. But if part of that, you know, we talk about that's the vulnerability aspect, and we're looking at the workloads, you know, your actual VMs, containers, things like that. Misconfigurations and CSPM comes into that next level. Again, you don't control this environment. It's an environment that you're renting, sometimes paying a very high price to rent. And you want to know, okay, are all those virtual resources, my networks, my database, everything like that, my credentialing and identity components of that, seeing those side by side with the vulnerability information gives you a much broader view. And, you know, agent solution, while perfectly valid, won't give you the view of the environment. They don't know that they're in the cloud. They know an awful lot about the system that's running, but they don't know that next level. And part of the CNAPP of these two components, vulnerability management, CSPM is that component.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Again, giving context to these alerts and making the alerts that we flag up the ones that you actually have to do. And also, if you can get a code snippet or something, we can show something like that as well. We can facilitate the remediation of these stories. So first of all, if we prioritize the ones we need to do, and then you can have the best tools in the world, but if nobody's using them, then they're not worth anything. So a lot of the parts that I'm interested in and always have been is what's the human way, or what's the human, I don't want to call it problem, maybe a challenge. Right. What's the opportunity? Human opportunity
here. Yes. So, opportunity. Well, and that's a good segue, because the next core principle of CNAPP is that infrastructure is code scanning. And I'm going to show another, I'm going to share this again. If I can figure it out. It's always a challenge. And infrastructure's code scanning is this idea of, most of your cloud resources. I mean, yeah, you can go into the dashboards of Azure and AWS and click some things and choose an AMI and manually configure things. But most folks who are using these environments are using infrastructure's code. You're using Terraform and they're using Docker and Helm and others out there to do that. So, and the idea here is having the ability, and you can see in my thing, I have some scans of some code that I have sitting in a Git repository. But the idea here is, okay, now I'm going to move away from the cloud environment scanning, which is important, but I'm going to move what we call left, shifting left, right to the developer's workstation, do some testing, an analysis really right there. Then as the stuff gets pushed to a repo, can be analyzed there. When it's pulled into a CI or CD pipeline, it can be analyzed and actually do things like stop builds and things like that. Talk a little bit about that, and I'm going to show off a couple of things.
Yeah, yeah, you do that. I can't possibly multitask, so that'd be great. So we talk about cloud security posture management and infrastructure as code in the same conversation. The reason that I always do that is that I wouldn't consider a CSPM tool to be particularly useful unless it also had an infrastructure as code scanning component. Because I don't know about you, but and the people on the call, but I've been in so many, in fact, every place I've ever gone into has this sprawling cloud estate, and they've got lots of virtual machines and resources and containers. They're not tagged correctly. And then you can try and do this retrospective tagging policy and pay your cloud security architects or even your cloud architects, for a couple of weeks to come up with this complicated tagging process. But then rolling it out is just almost impossible. So if I can link the infrastructure as code commit in my Git repository to the asset that's running in real time in my environment and vice versa, then I've basically taken out that tagging headache. So I can see, okay, this virtual machine, it's got no tags on it, I've got no idea what it is, but from here I can go and see, okay, I map this back to a commit, this commit has a developer's name on it, I can see what changes they made, I can see if it's production, I can see whether or who's responsible for it. If there's a security alert, I know who to throw it to. So this really helps in security operations for us to be able to attribute running infrastructure to the correct teams. And we're not just throwing these tickets over a wall and into a silo where people just either tell you it's not an issue, it's secure, or they deny that it's their problem. And then you've got all of this infrastructure you're too scared to get rid of because you don't know if it'll break production. So again, it's always the main driver for the things I like to evangelize might be a bit strong, but the things I like to encourage people to use, these things will actually help you. They'll take away a lot of your pain. And that's the main driver and one of the greatest reasons why your infrastructure as code should be linked to your running environments.
Yeah, and so that whole idea is like tagging is sort of an overlay, and it's not, it can be fully integrated, and a lot of people do that. It takes its own maintenance and management that way, and rather than sort of creating yet another layer to manage, you're integrating this process right into these tools so that you're not having to not just bop around, but to really link everything so everyone involved in that, if it's code update, can go and look. And you notice in here too that one of the features of Tenable is we always give you the remediation recommendation. And there's a mix of that. If it's code, there's actual code examples that you can grab. There are, if you're using the dashboard and things like that. But all this information is captured right from the source, from the actual security scan. Specific details about that are linked. So which means whoever does get the ticket or the pull request task doesn't have to guess. You don't have to restate the problem and doing, those kinds of things. I want to say, because you talked about the human element, it builds trust and it's smoother. There's no opinion as part of the process. And, based on what it is, you can route it through to the right teams, particular kinds of problems that way, without adding the overlay, without adding another layer of complexity to something that's already pretty complex.
Exactly. I've been on both sides. So if I say see any pain points, I know the both sides of it. If I'm in the DevOps team and I get told by security, you've got this security vulnerability, I'll be like, well, maybe I don't agree with it. Maybe I do, but I'm not sure exactly what it is you're asking me to do. Which exact assets are you saying? And what is the approved method of doing this? I've got four ways. So maybe I'll do it, and then security will still get on my back and say it's something else. So the very point of closing that circle for security operations to be able to create a very specific action that they need doing, they might even do it themselves at some point. But if you can create a specific change request, let's say, and you then can get it into a backlog, and you can get that ticket to developers. You give them everything that they need to get started on that ticket. They don't need to guess the story points. They don't need to put it in a backlog and then prioritize it. They just say, okay, this is one story point. Who's got it this week? And we can get it up and running. And you just grease the wheels of getting change to be implemented in your environment. And just, if it's just slowly and steadily moving that risk curve that I always talk about, the security is never an absolute. We can just move it, then we're continually moving that risk curve down and trying to improve. And I think that's one of the changes I had to kind of reset when I went from on-prem to cloud security, to be a lot more comfortable with living with the risk that we had. And
with ambiguity.
Right. Well, we're trying to slightly eliminate as much ambiguity as possible by giving as much visibility and context to this risk. So, like I say, we're trying to just make this as efficient as possible. Right. So, yeah.
That's great. So far, we've talked about runtime visibility, CSPM, infrastructure as code, and the fourth element here, cloud infrastructure entitlement management. This is a little different, and in some cases could be the realm of a specific team, because we're now talking about things related to identity sometimes and some stuff. So talk a little bit about the entitlement management.
Yeah, So it, when you have these multiple cloud accounts, again, I've never been anywhere where I've gone and worked with DevOps teams as a security engineer. And I've said, okay, the first thing we can do is, can we just print out, or I will print out on a spreadsheet, you can export this quite easily from your cloud provider or your cloud security provider, and give them a list of all, these are all the users that you've got. And you can say, right, okay, these passwords haven't been changed in 12 weeks, a year, sometimes 2 years. These passwords aren't strong enough. These have got API keys and they've got root access. We need to get those out of the way. And even just a manual stepping through, you can see quite often, oh, we've got five accounts that haven't been used and have got access for some reason. So we can talk about moving that risk curve with no impact. We can get rid of some of those overprivileged accounts quite quickly. But it gets so much more complicated in the cloud with identity being the perimeter. I can explain that. It's almost a cliche, but basically we've got virtual machines. Every entity in the cloud has its own permission set. So you don't really have that on-prem. You don't spin up a server and then give it permissions to execute instructions and create new infrastructure across your estate. But in cloud, you need to have permissions for almost everything that's running there. It's not just users, it's your virtual machines, your serverless functions, your database instances, and your S3 buckets, who can act, or your storage buckets rather. Each one of these has to have a permission set. And that's before I get on to the most common part is, you know, when people just want root access for one release and they say, yeah, we just need it for this release. We promise we'll delete it afterwards. And it's not feasible to think that that's going to happen over all of these estates. So the emergence of CIEM really came from the identity team saying, we need a way of constantly scanning for overprivileged user accounts, entity accounts and roles that would typically be assigned to virtual machines or pieces of infrastructure. And we need to be constantly scanning for that. You know, doing an audit every 6 months or every month is probably not the best way to go about that. If we can automate that part, then, again, we're maintaining least privilege. And we're ensuring that we're not open to these forgotten accounts.
Well, and I'm showing here, again, in the Tenable Cloud Security Dashboard, I'm under the projects and connections. And in here, I have my cloud accounts, and there's this Discover accounts. And you can see AWS, Azure, and GCP. And what this is doing, in line with what you're talking about, Tom, when you create an organizational account on one of these platforms that likely have many users who are doing their own thing and you don't really have visibility into what they're doing, you may have your policies, but you just don't know what's coming and going and who's doing that. This Discover accounts capability enables you to automatically discover those accounts. And once you are able to automatically discover them, scan them and go, why is this person doing this thing? how much privilege do they really need over here in this dev environment for X, Y, and Z? Again, it's a visibility
production account.
Right. It's a visibility thing that, and we say over and over again, and that identity, and, a vast majority of security problems are due to some kind of human error, whether it's, oops, I left that root account active and it has the keys to the kingdom and all that. And we'll look at some of that in the attack path. And so, it's not to be, to police it in a way that is preventing people from doing their work, but it is doing it in a way to say, okay, do your work within these parameters and let us help you, and not only do your work, but understand the policies that we're applying and how that could be risky to our entire environment, not just your little piece of a corner of the world.
Exactly. And that's not even starting on cross-account roles. You know, sometimes you have a third-party contractor come in, or maybe you've got a SaaS application and you give a cross-account role to another account. And then all of a sudden you come in 6 months later and nobody knows what it is. And it's sitting there and it's got access to your entire infrastructure. It's like, okay, we just forgot to patch this hole in the wall that we made in our data center. And now with someone we don't even know can just walk in and out of it without us knowing. So,
well, it always underscores the thing, you know, the cloud is very powerful and it makes it very easy to do really bad things really quickly, you know, which has frankly kept some people away, you know, because they're like, we don't know what we don't know. And all of these tools are really designed to help you get not just be comfortable with ambiguity, but be much more confident in what you're deploying in these environments, whether you're, you know, tossing around a term like zero trust environments and things like that. But to really understand there and be confident, and not just be confident in yourself, but to be able to communicate to those above you and go, we're good over here, and here, I'm not just telling you, I can prove it with this, and, you know, from the user accounts. I pulled up here a view for our next capability conversation, which is on network connectivity mapping. And, you know, a key principle of the software-defined data center is you have to understand what's out there. And frankly, when I started using the cloud, I'd spin up some stuff using some Terraform. I'm like, yeah, this subnet's fine. The security group is fine. I'm fine. wasn't fine. And I was just banging around and stuff, but I was like, the defaults are not designed on purpose by the cloud vendors to lock you down. They provide a middle ground place for you to get started and things like that. But right out of the box, not so secure. And depending on what you're doing, you know, like if you're not, you've routinely not checking the encryption box on disks or on databases and stuff like that, right? Because you just want your thing to work and figure it out, and then you'll go for. But talk a little bit about network connectivity mapping as part of CNAPP.
So, yeah, I mean, obviously networks being software defined now, it's very easy to spin these things up. It's very easy to make these changes. Not all of our changes go through a change request to a firewall team who then gets them signed off and we have an audit trail. It's far more common that you find these configuration mistakes after the fact. So, you know, we talked about ports being open earlier, and that's a typical example. But it could also be that we have a VPN tunnel to another data center or software-defined data center somewhere that isn't configured correctly. We could even have a misconfigured VPN back to our on-prem. And it could be this fiber that we've got that we think is incredibly secure because it's a dedicated fiber. We wanted that to have network level encryption. And all of a sudden we realize, oh, this VPN isn't encrypting. And we're sending passwords in plain text. We're sending all of this in plain text across our network, which is not ideal. It's suboptimal. In some cases from a security perspective. So these configuration errors, again, they occur quite frequently. And a lot of the time, like you said there, John, you were probably in this safe sandbox, but quite a lot of the time, you know, a lot of my developers or people I've worked with or I have had access to dev accounts, but there's some information in there that we don't really want to be leaking. You know, I might have a subset of data that I'm working with, and I've got access to just spin up new networks, spin up new internet gateways, and make them internet facing, create a little WordPress site here, and it's connected to this database at the back end. And, you know, it's these unscheduled and unsupervised, I suppose, Network changes are just so easy to scale out as Terraform, Script, CloudFormation, whatever it is, a blueprint, that they're better to be detected than stopped, you know. So the first part, you can't do any of that unless you know what's out there. And so there's quite a lot of networks and VPNs and VLANs that you wouldn't even know existed unless you had a tool that was constantly scanning for this. And that's really what we need to be able to do. And to be able to enforce those controls as well, we need we can't just put firewalls, virtual appliances everywhere throughout our network, because they're expensive. They have bandwidth limitations, and they become bottlenecks or choke points for our for some of our traffic. So we can't enable developers to have the freedom to innovate and create some of our more valuable, whether it be products or applications. We can't have innovation without taking some risk. So in order to free up people, in order to do that, we need to have some checks and balances. And I think that's really what we're pushing towards here. That's the fundamental idea.
I'm sharing here the attack path analysis, because there's a link to this, and we've had some conversation about this, that it's not just the network, and the attack path analysis is part of Tenable One. And in here, you know, we can look at different thing. I can say here's the WannaCry ransomware attack. You know, what does this look like? Doesn't mean I'd have it already. It means, what if I open this port? What's the path a hacker could use? And this is showing, you know, going from a Windows machine all the way over to a domain controller and wreaking havoc. And explain how this is part of CNAPP, an important key.
Yeah. So, you know, on-prem, it's quite easy to go and do some brute force network scanning and see and poke around a bit and see what's actually what's exploitable and where the possibilities for exploit are. You cannot do that in the cloud, because AWS or Microsoft or Google or any of the other clouds will look at that correctly as an attack on their environment. So you can jump through some hoops and do some limited scanning like that, but it's not really the way we want to do things. What's far more practical is to have a continuous kind of read-only breach and attack simulator, I would call it. We're saying that, okay, if I have WannaCry, I mean, here we're saying, show me all of the instances that are susceptible to WannaCry. And we can say, well, what if that instance becomes compromised? Well, here are all the other instances or data stores that it's connected to. And here are the ones that could potentially be compromised. We can see the blast radius and we can illustrate it. So again, this is the show don't tell aspect, that it's a lot more convincing to get that story into the backlog of this application team, or get the line of business heads to think twice before signing off this risk, or just to get the product owner to say, right, we're going to do this. We're going to do this story and take some development time away and do this security story, when you can show them what's at risk. It's like, we're not saying this is a theory, this is actually exploitable. And this is a really good visualization tool and a very persuasive way of doing so.
It also shows you criticality, right? Like you said earlier, you know, port 22 being open isn't universally bad because of what's running there. And if you're running attack path analysis to say, like, oh, okay, it's you know, someone can get access, but they're stopped here, or they go all the way to a domain controller or whatever. It's helping you really understand those pieces. And it also helps in the resolution. And, you know, here's an example of all the connected parts and pieces that you may be able to resolve quite a few policy problems, misconfigurations, vulnerabilities by tracking it through an attack path and going, this is the weak spot. Or these two areas will shut down 70% of it. you know, it's not, I have 100 things now to resolve. It's like, no, I can track it back to, this is our Achilles heel. And if I remediate this thing, I can figure out something and get to a better place, period. Yeah.
Exactly. And, you know, you could even be looking at a jump box, like a Bastion server, which is supposed to have SSH open, but you can use that to ensure that the controls that you have in place are valid. So you might be running attack path management on secure devices just to validate their security. I don't know anyone who enjoys taking screenshots and pasting them into a change ticket and saying, okay, I've done this. I've scanned, running, you know, PS command on each one of these instances. Then I've gone to the firewalls and I've checked those. I don't know anyone who enjoys doing that. If we can get an automated continuous tool that gives us a continuous and validated picture of our risk, then that's a far better way than taking this point in time labor intensive audit trail. And trying to scale that across the cloud, it's just not practical. Right. So,
and being going from defense to offense in addressing issues earlier, because you know, like, okay, here's, if we do this, it's going to cause a lot of problems.
And potentially you can even simulate, so you can say, okay, this is secure, this Bastion box now, or whatever it is, and you can say, what would happen if I suddenly installed this on here? So you could even validate infrastructure changes as part of some kind of approval process. And change management isn't as popular as it once was, but you can see what's the impact going to be if, you know, we change this application to use a new library and this process is running on this port, and well, is it open? What can access it? So we can even use it as a proactive tool to simulate what the effect of a change might be, or even just say we're one mistake away from losing the crown jewels here. Maybe we need to put another check and balance in before someone opens up a new hole in this firewall.
Right. So, you know, that whole thing with network connectivity, attack path, the next CNAPP capability, core principle I want to talk about is scanning containers. And we touched on this earlier, but I want to loop back to it because unlike virtual machines or even bare metal, and whether they're, it's you know, IoT devices up to massive servers, containers, you know, don't lend themselves to agents. You can do it, but it's just not ideal for this environment. But containers have many components based on the images, and then applications built from those have multiple images, you know, tens, hundreds. I think Netflix, basic Netflix, is something like 500 right. container, like separate images to build the Netflix experience, each of those providing an attack surface. But traditional ways of scanning that, like, you're not really scanning the runtime. You can, and there are tools to do that, and we have, you know, capabilities, but it's really, okay, what is the code you're using? What are the image? Let me look at the image registry. Talk a little bit about that arc within CNAPP.
Yeah, so you know, we've been talking for many years, and it's not been security guys, it's been DevOps guys that have been talking about cattle, not pets, immutable infrastructure. And it's always been a little bit aspirational. You know, I mean, you want to spin up a virtual machine and make that immutable, and it's got some in-house application on it. I mean, good luck with that. It's always been, so just in case for anyone who doesn't know, the idea of immutable infrastructure is we spin it up once and then we don't let anybody log in and do any changes. Everything comes from code. Ideally, we would take the entire application down. We'd have a green blue deployment. These are all very old ideas in DevOps, at least 10 years anyway. And And ideally, we would create new infrastructure because we can in the cloud, and we would just do point our load balancer to the new one, see if it works, and then we can fail back if we have to. So the idea of having a mutable infrastructure in a container is actually a lot more practical. These things spin up and down very quickly, and they come from blueprints, and they may have a life of only 2 or 3 hours, and we might choose to replace them. So we might have 1,000 applications that are 1,000 containers in this application, and we might have 1,000 applications. So if you want to spin up each one of these containers, install an agent, get it to verify that it's sending telemetry for all of these containers, okay. But I don't think that's the best way to go about it. Luckily, with containers, we can also just say, look at the Docker file. We can check your image registries, and we can say, okay, so for all of these layers, I mean, each layer in a container, if people don't know, is really just a tarball, if you can think about it in old money. And each one of these layers in the Docker file can be analyzed for known vulnerabilities. And so we can say, this container image has this vulnerability as referenced by this CVE. Therefore, once you spin this container up into production, it will have this vulnerability. And then we can start to look at what it's connected to, put that vulnerability into context and say, yeah, you know, you'll have it, but don't worry. you can patch it at this time or that time. Or conversely, you should not spin this container up. Even if it's only going to be alive for a couple of hours, there's a serious chance that this is going to be exploited. And when you're scaling that out to 1,000 containers, there's 1,000 attack surfaces to go from. So it might be a shorter window, but you've got 1,000 of them. So that risk being impact times likelihood equation starts to become more realistic. So we can do this in a static way now, is what I'm really saying, by scanning registries.
And it's more appropriate, you know, than, you know, doing a network scan on a bunch of containers and things that technically are identical. In part of your process may very well be, okay, I'm going to scan a random collection of the containers made from this image, made from this workflow, perfectly valid. But as an ongoing basis, you're not going to fix it by shelling into that thing and turning something off or updating a packet. You know, you tear it down and replace it. And obviously, you know, we talked about this in other places too, that, you know, car manufacturers don't want to fix stuff, you know, in recalls when a car is out on the road. They want to fix it in the factory. That's what it is. The great thing is, if you're a software developer, you know, creating a car takes a long time. Spinning up a new container based on a couple code changes, very rapid and inexpensive, you know, when it comes to a remediation, you know, when you're looking at that, it's cheaper for a whole bunch of reasons. And you can more confidently analyze that rather than going, okay, I got a million containers running, let me scan them. Oh my God, where do I start? Where do I end? Then you're really drinking something other than coffee.
Yeah, and as well, right, we can, you were talking about SSHing into a container. We don't want people doing that. And we can check whether someone's done that. So, you know, we're never going to get rid of real-time runtime scanning for everybody. But it is a possibility that you can say, we're going to spin up these containers. We're going to make them immutable. Or what we're going to do is we're going to say, we can detect if anyone's logged into them, made any changes. If it is, we just kill that container and relaunch it. And then we can work out if someone keeps doing this, then we can keep reverting it back to the container image while we scramble around and get this patch done. That's very rare, but I'm taking this as, you know, as far as it can go to say, look, we can cover this without having real-time EDR agents, for example, sitting on these containers. We can have, we can make them mutable, have a short runtime, and we can decrease the window of exploit in a number of ways that make runtime less important if we're going by these principles. So Yeah.
And speaking of principles, the last principle, and we have a few minutes here left, is, you know, the final core principle of CNAPP is the software composition analysis. And this takes on a little different approach than everything we've talked about before. Now we're talking, we are talking about those things that are, you know, your application that you're running and being able to scan that. Here at Tenable, I'm gonna try to share the screen again and make sure I pick the right one, which is hard to do. There we go. This is Tenable WAS, which is web application security. And here I have something running in the scan right now. And I can look at the details. I just want to show the details of this. And this is just a simple, you know, web server running a couple simple apps. And now I'm looking at, I got some issues here with my version of jQuery and a bunch of other stuff in here. Some are high, some, you know, medium and low and everything else. Talk a little bit about the, you know, the software bill of materials and the software composition analysis.
Yeah, so again, especially in the container world, but even in the VM world, we're now being asked more and more to identify what software we have running in a system. And that can be pretty tricky if we want to go and try to put together a list of every library and every application that's using, you know, that's been used to build custom code or custom applications. Again, if we can take the same approach that I was talking about for containers and say, well, each layer of this application, each application is using this library, and we can go through the code repositories and say, this library has this issue here, you're using it on each one of these 17 different applications and these virtual machines, and we can quantify this risk a little bit better and say it's exploitable on machines A, B, and C. Not only that, we can create this software bill of materials, this inventory of what's running in our systems by looking at the code repositories that are being used and are being scanned by our security software to generate a list of known software in use, and then by the next step being known vulnerabilities in the software that we're using. Then this can be automated and feed into that overall church, I'm going to call it now that we refer to as CNAPP. So it's another point of telemetry that gives us another layer of context that helps to give us a more complete overall picture of our risk exposure across our cloud estate. And it can be done with integrated tooling. And if we break down the silos between some of these traditional tools, I mean, it's not a new concept really that I'm talking about. It's just bringing it into the contextualized CNAPP umbrella. We can give a more accurate description of risk. In fact, one of the things from one of the surveys we did in Gartner across the board was, what's the number one pain point for application teams? And they said, well, we've got all of these vulnerabilities in our application, but without the context of where it's running, we don't know which ones to go fix first or which ones we don't need to worry about. So it's not just that the infrastructure teams that can benefit from this prioritization of vulnerability. The application teams as well can say, like, which ones do we need to fix first? And then once these tools talk to each other, you can actually have fewer security controls in place, slowing you down, than you would necessarily otherwise need.
Great summary. And we're almost out of time. We do have a question from Kurt Fitzpatrick asked, with Intenable CS, how would I configure an alert or a notification for whenever a project scan develops a new misconfiguration or vulnerability? And I want to quickly show this. So let me go back over here. So I'm going into this project, the alerts here. and I can select different ways to deliver these things. But I can also go in, you know, what are my active policy groups? This is what I was talking about, that are triggered. But hopefully that'll give you a little bit of idea. Before we leave, I want to do one poll based on these seven things that we were talking about. And for those who've stayed with us, thank you. You know, which of these seven core CNAPP capabilities do you have in place today? And again, I wouldn't expect everybody to have these, but all of them. But if you can weigh in, that would be great. This is a multiple choice. You know, we talk about a lot of different capabilities here, and I hope you, as as we're wrapping up, your takeaway is that, you know, we're looking forward in time at what are the capabilities that teams, the real human beings that have to deal with this stuff, have in place to address these problems, to decrease their ambiguity, to cover the bases of these very unique and complex environments known as public clouds, and go from there. We still have some folks answering. I'm going to end the poll in a second, because we're just a little bit over, just so you can see. That's good. And I'm gonna share the results. And you can see, you know, folks, as I would expect, VM and CSPM and infrastructure code are high. Software composition analysis, I would expect to be low. It's very hard to do, but we do have some things in place right now. That's it for us today. Thanks again, Tom Croll from Lionfish, for being aboard. Really appreciate the insights. Join us in 2 weeks for another show. We'll be talking about I think drift management is next on deck, and then we have some other things post KubeCon. Stay tuned for. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day.
Thanks.